Hello everyone, I am Sushmita Sarkar. I am Assistant Professor in Electrical Department of RV College of Engineering. So today I'm here to give you more insight into power quality in Module 2, which talks about the sources of voltage sags and interruption. I hope Module 1 is pretty clear to all of you, which was handled by Dr. Kiyoma Rao, and she would have explained all about the basics of the power quality, why the power quality is becoming so bad, and you know, what are the different terms and terminologies we use under certain standards. So in this particular chapter, we will be studying about, you know, what are the sources of your voltage sags. Fine, so, and interruptions. So this module is all about the voltage sags and interruptions. So first lecture, we are going to read about all sources which are related to sags and which causes the sags and the interruption. Second lecture, we will understand the estimation voltage sag and performance. Third one, we'll talk about the fundamental principle of protection. Okay, now how to come out of these sags, if the sags, because you cannot, the sags and interruptions are the part of the system. So I have certain protection device, I should have some protection devices, or I should design the system in such a way that we can come out of these sags and interruption as fast as possible. You know, then the motor starting sags means how does this motor contributes into a voltage sag and what are these? Then we will go for transient overvoltages. So transient overvoltages, we have seen and we have observed these kind of transients, you know, the sudden change, the sudden flickering in our tube lights and all, the small, because these are very short period. So we are going to learn about this in this particular section, that sources of transients overvoltages, you know, the principle of these overvoltage protections, and utility capacitor switching transients, because they are the major reason to cause these transients in overvoltages. Fine, so with this, let us start our first lecture under Module 2. So we are going to read about sources of sags and interruption. Fine, so my dear friends, first we should understand that, you know, at the utility sector, the people are really worried about, as they are getting a lot of complaints which are raising at the utility end about the poor power quality due to these sags and interruptions. You know, and the major reason behind these sags and interruptions are the sensitive devices which are used by the customer end, what consumer end, what we are using it. You know, as I already told you that we are right now in digital world where everything we touch is in digital mode. No, you talk about your system, computers, you talk about your mobiles, everything is having an electronic devices. So where the electronic system comes, you are injecting the poor power quality into the system. Fine. So keeping all those things in mind, so we say the power quality is mainly, so we are going to learn about these sources with one beautiful case study also. And whatever the learning objectives we learn from this particular chapter is, first you will understand the concept of sag and interruption, which I'm very sure you have learned already in Module 1. But let us revise once before we go to the sources behind all these interruptions and sags. Fine. Next, sources of power quality issues, from where these are raising, what are the issues behind this poor power quality, you know. Then the concept of voltage sags and interruption at the utility end. Exactly what is happening, just now what I told you, that the major problem which are coming into picture is from the utility end. So what are the major sources or the concept behind all these problems? You know, the next we'll read about the voltage sags due to short circuited fault on the parallel feeder. We'll just check out once example where we'll see what happens if the fault occurs in the same feeder or the fault happens in the parallel feeder, what is the exact effect at the consumer end. Fine, then we will be doing one case study, and very important, after end of all these we'll have one small quiz sessions. Fine. Now, so just brush up the Module 1. you know, module one has covered almost all these basic concepts where we talk about, where we define a voltage, you know, nominal voltage, which keeps your system in 1 per unit and a 50 hertz frequency in India. Fine, so you have to maintain that voltage and maintain that frequency. And if anything goes above or below it, you know, that means you are not delivering a good power quality. You are not maintaining a good power quality. So you can see in the below examples, all shows, you know, that these are the deviations from your normal value. So you can see the overvoltage. Overvoltage is a voltage which goes above your nominal per unit value. So if you say your nominal waveform has to maintain a 1 per unit, and if it crosses that, then we say if it consisted for a longer period, we talk it in terms of an overvoltage. Then sudden surges which comes into the system due to, this may happen due to any reasons, you know, due to any switching which is happening into the system, may cause surges into your system. Then we have learned about the spikes. You can even see the difference between the surge and a spike. Spike is a single, you know, the moment at which, a single instant where the system has just lost its normality, normal behavior, and just goes ups and downs. So, you know, that is what your spikes is all about. And like similarly, we have already done transient frequency variations. Under voltage, you define under voltage also in the same circumstances when the voltage is below a certain level for a longer period, more than a 1 minute, then only you define it as an under voltage, you know. So similarly, sag means it is a dip in the voltage, because some people use, some countries use the language as a dip, some country use it as a sag. You know, so the dip in the voltage or the sag in the voltage is nothing but your waveform is not able to maintain that 1 per unit nominal waveform, you know, and below that 10% and 90% to 10% dip in the voltage as per the IEEE 11159 standard, you define it as a voltage sag. Similarly, the next comes as a blackout. So whether we call it as a blackout or we tell in other terms as an interruption. So that means the system has come to a halt. Fine. And you know, this is literally a serious issue in a power quality system. You know, power, when you talk about a power quality and the term comes blackout. So it's a major issues which we are really concerned about, because any interruptions may result into a financial losses in a big industries, you know. So definitely the noise, anything which is disturbing your normal waveform, we define it as the noise, and the harmonics which are at different higher frequencies, which are resulting your getting aided with your fundamental frequencies, and the system completely, you know, have a altogether different behavior. So with this, all these concepts which you have learned in module one, similarly in the module two, we have just brushed up the basic concepts, and now here we are just I just wanted to give you a brief idea about what actually happens. So you first do the power quality problem evaluation. So now, you know, for how do I do that? How do I evaluate if I know there is a problem in the system? How do I go about it? So for that, what do you have to do? First job, you know, it's very basic thing, and I know first I have to identify the problem. Exactly what is the problem? From where the problem is coming from. So that is what the first step comes from, the identifying of the problem. What is your problem? Only when I know what is the problem, I can find out the solution of it. As simple as that, you know. So the problem is happening. That means I'm able to see the problem in terms of flicker, or there is a harmonic distortion, or a voltage regulation, or sag or transient. You know, so these are the different, there may be much more than this. Which can be, which will help us to identify, yes, there is certain problem existing into the system. Then what I do next, I have to characterize that problem. So that characterization of problem means I should know exactly the behavior of the problem, how it is having an impact on the equipment, what are the reasons behind this particular behavior of, or this particular problem issue which is happening into the power quality. And then various characteristics which we can observe in the various scales, you know, whether you talk about a voltage, you talk about a current. So you have a different parameters to make out that absolutely there is some sort of differences which are happening into the system. Then find out the range, you know, exactly what is your upper limit and lower limit. Is it going out of the range, or whether it is within the range? You know, when you know it is within the range, it is controllable. And if it goes out of the range, then what should I do the next step? So that is what depends on your equipment design. So this identifying of the range solution is what about you're going to find out that whether it is all from the end users it's coming, or it is coming from the utility sector. And you know how your equipment is designed, what is the limit of that equipment, whether it is going to able to withstand this power quality issue or not. Then you come to the solution, how exactly I should solve this problem. When you came to know the exactly cause, what is the characteristics, what is, I have actually identified where is the exactly problem is lying, then I come to the solution part. You know, so then I find out what are the solutions which are possibly can be implemented to solve this issue. So you have a procedure analysis, or you have evaluate technical alternatives. So you have the regular analysis which you are doing from years and years to solve a certain problem, or this is some typical issues which need a separate solution methods, you know. And then you think about the solutions which you have the solutions which you have thought of, whether it is optimal or not, you know. So then it comes to an optimal solutions. Do I have a backups? So the optimal solutions talks about the backups. So what are the backups are attached into my system, are fed into a system which can sustain this particular faults, you know. So that is how this whole issue of the power quality can be evaluated. So that I just wanted to give you a brief understanding before you go for the sources. Let us have a full idea exactly how the issues have been, you know, categorized, or the issues have been find out exactly the exact mode of problem, and then how to come out with an optimal solution of it. Fine. So when we talk about an issues, so there are sources of power qualities. A lot of issues, sources are there behind these issues. So that can be from your utility end, or it can be certain internal issues based on the type of loads you have attached in your in your system, or the, as I have already discussed all about the power electronic devices. You know, so when we talk about the utility sources, it's all talk about the switchings, the power factor regulations which you are maintaining, the power factor correction equipments, the faults which are happening at the utility end. Similarly, when I talk about internal sources, basically I'm talking about all the loads which are present in my system, the various different types of loads, starting from your light loads to a very, very highly inductive loads to a majority medical loads, which are electronic devices, you know. So these loads impact a lot in your power quality issues, you know. So as I already told you, the power electronic sources are something which are making a lot of difference or the creating a lot of problem in the power quality. So when you talk about a power quality sources, so these, you can see that all these which are right now a present present topic, which people are right now working on smart grid, smart cities. And when you talk about a smart, obviously the devices which you are going to use are power electronics. And you just can imagine the kind of disturbances it is going to inject into your grid, you know. So there is a big question mark, how to resolve all these issues when so much of devices are going to integrate together and put it onto the system. So that's where a power quality engineer can work on. So, you know, you have a lot of research aspects also in this particular area, because right now we all are talking about smart cities and smart networks. So, all are dealing with power electronic devices, and how to come out of, how to find the solution to make the power quality, or to how to maintain the power quality in much more better way. So that's a lot of work into it, you know. So therefore, let us start with our main topic, exactly what a module one talks about, the sources of SAGs and interruptions. So there are a lot of sources in which basically, you know, there's a fault. So there's something called as a fault, which is happening due to your LLG fault or your line to line faults, or something which is falling on the line, or also by accidentally, you know, when the fall, when there's a high wind, heavy wind, and something falls on the transmission line, is also creating a fault. And so these kind of faults are a major reason for behind the sags and interruptions. And, you know, and then you have a huge loads, the huge loads which you are putting into the system suddenly, and switching or turning on these loads causes a dip in your system voltage. Okay, fine. So these are the reasons which we'll read one by one. Okay, so what is it the first point talks about? So the first point talks about that there is an voltage sag and interruptions are related to power quality problems. Obviously, just now we were talking about this only because, you know, sags, somehow if my system is able to sag, will not bring your system to a halt. But the interruption is something your system comes to a halt, and interruption is a serious issue. Fine, so they are the major issues which utility and people's utility end is majorly are seeing. So what are these, why these are happening first of all? So as I told you, they are mainly happening due to the faults in the power system that can be, that can happen by any accidental way, or it can be for many other different reasons behind it for which the fault has taken place. And there will be a lot of switching actions. So switching actions also relate with your sudden increase or decrease in your loads, you know, especially the machines, motors. So a voltage sag is a short duration. You have seen already in module, or you have studied already in module one, that your voltage sag is basically categorized into three sections. So what are these three sections? Let us recall. So you call it about as an, you know, very instant voltage sag, you know, instantaneous voltage sags. So when I talk about an instantaneous voltage sag or for a short duration, which means I'm talking about typically between 0.5 to 30 cycles, fine. After that, I have something above 30 cycles to 3 seconds has been defined as momentary voltage sag. Okay, and above 3 seconds to 1 minute, we call it as a temporary voltage sag. Now, what happens more than 1 minute? Anything, any sag existing more than 1 minute is called as or defined as under voltage. Fine. So we should know a terminology in power systems are very, very important. You know, which term we, because when we talk about these terms, they look very, you know, look alike. You know, when I talk about a sag, I talk about a dip, I talk about a momentary, temporary, or under voltage, all looks very, very same. But in a technical term, or in IEEE or IEEE standards, when you try to define them, you can find the exact difference between these individual words, you know. So that's why we where we should differentiate exactly what do I mean by a voltage sag or a dip, or what do I mean by a under voltage. So anything more than 1 minute is defined as an under voltage. So now let us read this. A voltage sag is a short duration reduction in the RMS voltage. So your RMS voltage falls down for a short duration period that may happen due to any sort of faults, or may happen the switching off over of your loads, which can be your motors, your machines, any type of machines, you know, and the momentary interruptions. So the momentary interruptions, which majority system experience on day-to-day basis, that is typically for 2 to 5 seconds. You know, this, it is not that interruptions are happening every day. You know, it should not happen. If your system is really designed properly, then we should eliminate that word interruptions. You know, so it should not happen. But sometimes it is unavoidable and it happens. And that really results into a loss of a, which means it's a loss of a voltage. You just completely black out for that particular moment, whether it is happening for a few seconds to a few minutes, but it really, you know, it has a huge impact on the business sector. You know, especially the places, the sensitive devices like your medical equipments, if they just come to a stop, halt, you know what will happen to the patients. And into the big, big industries and business people, if there's a halt, they have a huge loss of data, and which costs them a lot, which means a lot to them. They can go up to a bankrupt. So, you know, so these are the situations which is really need to be taken care. And that's how we should see the system is having an enough backup supply or enough backup design so that the system never comes to a halt mode. And if it comes, I have a certain plan B to act on. Find sustained interruptions of longer than 1 minute are generally due to permanent faults. Okay, so that means if I'm talking about interruptions happening for a longer period, that means there is something serious issues, and that issues are be defined as a permanent faults. Fine, next, we are just taking one system that is a fault location at the utility sector, because we told you that these issues are mainly being seen in utility sector. So we are just taking one utility sector, and this utility sector talks about feeders, number of feeders have been added. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4 feeders. This is completely your distribution side and this is your transmission side. So here in this case, what we will see is if there is a fault on the same feeder, how the things will be on the customer end, okay, consumer end, or if it is in the parallel feeder, what will happen at the consumer end, and if it's on the transmission line, what will happen to the another end. You know, so these are the three different cases which we are going to study. So it is very obvious, see, if there is a fault is happening at the same line, if you are connected to the same line, that means you are connected to the same feeder and fault is happening, for an example, let me say a feeder number 4. So if suppose you are connected to a feeder number 4 and the fault has happened at the feeder number 4, it will lead to a sag and definitely lead to an interruption if it is not being, you know, if the system does not come back to its original state. Fine, then there is chances of interruptions. But if the fault has happened in any one of the parallel feeder, you suppose the fault has happened now in the feeder number 2 and you are at the feeder number 4. So the chances of interruptions are very, very minimal, but definitely you are going to experience a voltage sag due to the fault in the parallel feeder. So usually what we see, unless my line is not going to get overloaded, fine, I will have a voltage, but there may be a dip in the voltage. Okay, so if there's a fault in the parallel feeder, so you will experience a voltage dip, not an interruption, unless your line is not getting overloaded. Fine, next, if the fault is happening at the transmission end, somewhere in the transmission end, there is a transmission system, there is some fault has happened. So here some case we have taken, let us say the fault has been taken at this particular line. So because you know this distribution station is getting feeded by 2 parallel lines. So you have A and F, you can see that there is a 2 parallel lines which is feeding to this feeder. So if that one fault has happened in one line, so still you have another line which is supplying to it. But you know, it depends on the kind of load it is able to feed it. So what will happen, the consumer end will still again fill the dip in the voltage. Fine, it will not be a completely shut down, but it will experience a dip in the voltage because one of the line got affected due to some reason. And this fault can also be, so here it is, as in this particular example, it shows that this fault has been created due to this single line to ground fault. Now this fault can only be cleared by when you open this A and B breaker. So when the breaker A and breaker B gets open, and that will take around 5 to 6 cycles to, you know, just the whole thing to happen. So that fault can only be cleared by opening of these breakers. So that will take certain, you know, certain time period, certain duration to bring this line back to a normal supply. Till then, this parallel line has to manage with this. So when the parallel line alone is managing the feeder end, distribution end, definitely the distribution end consumers will face a sag in the voltage. So this is what all about this case study. So let us read one by one. So those who have not cleared till the issue, just read one by one. So voltage sag interruptions are generally caused by faults, which we talk about short circuit faults on the utility system. If there is a fault on the same feeder, the customer will experience a voltage sag during the fault, followed by an interruption when the breaker opens to clear the fault. So if the fault has happened at the same feeder, you know, where you are connected to, and the fault has to be cleared only by opening of the breaker. So when the breaker will open, definitely you will get a, for a short duration, the system will be off. You know, so you will find an interruption over that particular moment. So, and it depends on how long this interruption will be, that how fast breaker can bring, restore the system back into the normal state. A much more common event would be a fault on the other feeders. Yeah, you know, now I have told about you this, the problems which the source of the fault, which can come from the same feeder or a parallel feeder or from a transmission system. So at the end, I have put a pie chart which will show the percentage of which will be more. So actually in the practical system, we see the percentage of the fault or the person why you are getting a voltage sag, that is due to the fault in the parallel feeder. So that contributes a lot, you know. So a much more common event would be a fault on one of the other feeders from the substations. That is a fault on a parallel feeder or a fault somewhere on the transmission system. Fine. So in either of the cases, whether you have fault on your feeder, at the same feeder or at the parallel feeder, in both the cases, you are going to experience a voltage sag. You know, the voltage sag during the period that fault is actually on the system. So customer is going to face the voltage sag, no matter whether it's the same feeder or a different feeder. You know, so the to clear the fault shown in the transmission system, as I told you, there is a fault happened at the transmission system. So one of the load will be completely delivered by the second line. And there definitely there will be a some time it will take for the first line to come back into a parallel line to come into a system. So that is depending on the time with which this breaker A and B operates. So usually they take 5 to 6 cycles, which we have already discussed. So in this case, there are two lines supplying the distribution system as a fault. Therefore, the customer supplied from the substation should expect to see only a sag, not an interruption, as you have the second healthy line, which is giving you the continuous supply. So you may have a dip in the voltage, but not the interruption. So the distribution fault on feeder 4 may be cleared either by the lateral. So how do you clear the fault in the distribution end? So you either clear it by with the help of a breaker or with the help of the fuse. You know, so I hope all of you know the difference between breaker and a fuse. So that depends on what is the practice at the utility end they do it, you know, on the daily basis. Any of these fault locations can cause equipment to misoperate. You know, so these kind of faults will result into misoperation of your equipment in customer facilities. So this particular topic only we are going to do the case study at the end. So if there is a fault happening at the utility end or at the transmission end, how exactly the equipments in your house are going to behave? So that case study we'll see there, which is really quite interesting. Now what happens? The relative importance of the faults in the transmission system and distribution system will depend upon, yes, of course, yes. You know, when we talk about something has gone wrong at the utility end or at the transmission end, so that depends on that, how, what is the exact characteristics, whether you're talking about the overhead lines, whether the fault, the things is, what is the characteristics of the fault? Okay, what is the reason for that the fault has occurred? So it all depend on the specific characteristics of the system and of the fault. And then the sensitivity of the equipment, which are dealing with that particular, you know, the breakers have to operate immediately. So how much time the breaker is taking to restoring the system back into the line. So these are all the two, that's why I have put it in a bold. So you can, when you read something in bold in the whole line, you know, these are the points which I have to remember. So that's what I put it, whatever in the whole line, whatever point is important, I just bold it. So it is very easy for me to I just look at those two words and just recall what is exactly the line is all about. So exactly for that, even for the exam also, or for to understand anything, you should bold it, which will, you know, just give you the concept faster. Now, as I told you, this pie graph, you know, all these graphs and contents, majority of the contents are from the book called Duggan. And it is a prescribed book for your syllabus and very beautifully written. Fine, you can just go through everything, you know, the pie charts are all available over there. So I've just put a little color over here so you can see exactly what I was talking about here. That is the faults which are happening from your own circuit or from your parallel circuit or from your transmission system. So you can see the percentage they contribute, you know. So you can see the 46% of the faults are causing mainly due to the faults in your parallel feeders, parallel lines, you know. That is the reason. So that's how they say the from your own line, it's 23%, very rare. Then it is 31% from the transmission line if something goes wrong. But basically it happens when it is happening in some other parallel lines. Now, voltage sag due to a short circuit fault on a parallel feeder. Since we said that parallel feeder contributes more into the voltage sag. So let us see what happens over here when there's a fault at the parallel feeder. So you can check over here if there is a fault on the parallel feeder. What is happening? You can check this, the first top graph. The top graph what talks about you are making adds 100%. That means it's talking about one per unit. So as the fault occurred, suddenly there is a dip in the voltage. There's a voltage sag. So voltage sag will fall down and it's lying down for certain seconds. So you can see the duration is for around 0.05 seconds. It comes back, systems comes back into the original state. So you can observe here the first 175 milliseconds, the waveform has been represented in the bottom graph. You know, the first, the it is an example. Somewhere the fault has happened and it has taken this particular, it is not that somebody has imagined, it has a practical values which has been taken. And you know, so this is, you can check that the first 175 millisecond cycles have been shown and recorded. So what do you say? The characteristics measured at the customer location on an unfaulted part of the feeder. So, you know, because we are talking about the parallel feeder. So fault has occurred at the parallel feeder. Now you are checking the readings because you want to see how the impact happened on the parallel lines. So exactly this characteristics has been measured, these characteristics have been measured by keeping your devices on the parallel lines where fault has not taken place. So how does the parallel line will get affected by the fault in another line? So what has happened? The top chart of the figure is the RMS voltage variation, obviously, because you usually account for an RMS voltage only. And the bottom chart talks about your 175, you know, first actual waveform for 175 milliseconds, which I already told you. It shows only a brief sag of 65% voltage for the first half, you know, first fast operation. So it's only showing for 65. You can see over here the sag. The sag comes down, it comes to below 70%. Exactly, but telling is quite difficult, but we roughly can say it's between 60 and 70. So we say around 65%, a brief sag can be visible. So almost 65% dip in the voltage when the fault has not taken place in your feeder, it has taken place in some other per parallel lines. Okay, so you can see the impact on your line, but definitely this impact depends on, you know, the area you come under. The we will be studying in the later lectures that area of vulnerability. So you, as you go away from this, you know, the area of the point of the location of the fault, you know, the dip will be gradually, you'll be decreasing, you'll be checking out that exactly what is happening you know, in the parallel lines as you go away from the fault location. Now, utility short circuit fault even with two fast trip operations of utility line reclosure. So what happens? How fast this fault has been cleared by two operations of your breakers. So what happens? So it says the utility short circuit fault event with two fast trip operations of utility line reclosure. Your line will get closed with two particular fast trip operations. And why it took two, why it is not one? There may be certain reason that due to which it could not clear the fault in one trip itself, you know. So you can see here it has taken for some time, it tried to clear, it could not clear. Again, it has taken the another second step and it is cleared after a while. No, so that is what it talks about. It shows the voltage sag prior to the fault clearing and the subsequent two fast reclosure operations have happened. So it is not cleared with the first reclosure because there may be some sort of, you know, maybe a tree has been fallen, a branch would have been fallen on the line due to which it is not cleared. And there may be some reasons by which it could not restore the system back in line, you know. So what happens, the reclosure time, the time the reclosure was open was a little more than a 2 second, a very common time for the utility line reclosure. Usually it takes a little bit more than a 2 seconds. You can check over here the time period over here. It takes a little bit more than a 2 seconds to try to clear the fault. So it could not clear at the first cycle. So again, it takes around, more than a little bit more than 2 seconds, and it clears the fault at the second operation. So the fault, perhaps a tree branch was not cleared completely by the first operation, forcing a second one. The system was restored after the second operation. So system comes back to a normal operation after a second. So you can see it goes and it comes back to the normal operation. So what are the things which we should keep it in mind? What happened? It all depends on your reclosing of the line. If your reclosing system is very sensitive and it's happening a very fast, you know, it's happening in very small period of time, you are not letting the voltage to come back to zero. You know, your system did not go to zero during the fault, because your system has operated so fast that it has not reached to the zero, and immediately your line have been closed and it has been restored. The line reclosure detected the fault and operated very quickly. There is a common misconception that usually the fault at the distribution end will be usually slower, you know, but it depends. It is not necessarily that it always be a slower. Sometimes it can be a faster, it can be, it all depends on the equipment which you have installed there. Since the voltage did not collapse to zero during the fault, induction machines, all the machines which were running, will keep continuing running and they'll keep feeding the fault, you know. So since this is, because if the system comes to zero, then definitely all the machines will come into halt. So, you know, if it comes to an halt point or interruption point, then it's a big loss to the industries. So we are trying not to bring that is a reason that your system has to be fast enough to sense the fault and bring the system back to the normal state. You know, that is what exactly we are talking in the last point, which we should note down. Since the system voltage has not come down to zero, so your machines which are connected into the system will keep feeding the fault. Now, summary. What is that? The summary is, there is any sudden increase in the load will result in corresponding drop in your voltage. So anytime, you know, the difference between variation and event. Variation is happening on day basis, 24 hours, your loads are not same. So that we call it as a variation. But when you talk about an event is something, some fault has happened, or something is happening for a duration, particular duration, then we call it as an event. So, you know, when there is a sudden increase or decrease in a load, definitely there will be dip in a voltage. So any sudden large increase in load will cause a voltage sag in motors. So that will also result, because obviously your motors are getting fed by these supplies only, you know. So there also the motors will also experience a voltage sag. And you know very well that whenever you turn on the motors, which you have studied in your very basics of engineering, that the motors will have a high inrush of current. So what will happen? These electric motors draw more inrush of current, and at the moment of starting, they draw a very high current. And when they into a running position, they come back to their rated current value. So rated speed they will maintain. So with this, what will happen? Obviously, when that immediately that starting inrush current will affect the voltage level, you know. So therefore, starting an electric motor can be a reason of voltage sag. These motors will contribute, maybe a major reason for experiencing a voltage sag for that small duration. Fine. So some accidents which we see happen, which we are talking, the major reasons of these sources of faults and interruptions. First major reason is your faults, which is your due to your lightning or due to falling something on the system, or some object is, as we have seen many times near our house also, that some branches falling on the transmission line and they're touching both the lines, you know. So these are the kind of things which are causing mainly lightning or this kind of short circuits happening. The faults which are created due to any reason are the major reason for voltage sag or interruption. Second reason, just now we talked about, is your the inrush current which is causing due to the starting of your machines. Fine. So these two are the major reason, and apart from that, also we have switching off loads and switching off the transformers, because when you need to energize the transformer, the switching action will take place, and that also will result into a voltage sag. Yeah, so that's how I was talking about this. The point comes, depending on the transformer connections, transformers energizing could be another reason for happening of the voltage sags. So this also contributes. So voltage sags can arrive from the utility, but most are caused by in-building equipments. So the equipments which we are having in our houses, you know, they are also at the consumer end, is also, we have seen a lot of electronic devices. When they turn on, you turn on your AC, you can, when you, at your home itself, when you turn on your AC, you can experience that voltage sag, you know. So whenever in your house you are turning on any heavy load, you can experience that voltage sag. So in residential homes, we usually see voltage sags when refrigerator, air conditioner, or furnace fan starts up. Now we'll come to a interesting part of this particular lecture, is a case study. Fine, so this case study has been taken from this particular website. And what is this? It talks about the effects of voltage sags on household loads. So how do you have, what are the loads you have in house, starting from your air conditioners, ovens, lighting system, how exactly they react with the voltage sag. Fine, so here is one interesting, the waveform they have drawn. So, you know, when there's a voltage sag, how do you know that is a sag has happened? So, you know, current will tend to come to zero. You know, current is coming to zero. So you can say this current will be coming near to zero. So it's a point of sag initiation. So here the point where the sag will start. So you can see the sag has, sag is very, very low. So it is a sag period. And after that, it takes some after, because these sags will happen for a few cycles, you know, it will be there for a few cycles. So with, for that few cycles, you can see that slowly that the current will increase, current will dip to zero, near to zero, and it will start then slowly, slowly gaining. And this is, as I told you, the lot of reasons behind this, why the sags are happening. And then you see the post-sag period, where the high current greater than the locked rotor current, signifying the stalling condition. Stalling condition, stalling means it's coming to a halt. The system is not working, it's coming to a halt position. So we see the pre-sag, sag, and post-sag condition exactly your air conditioning is working on. So what happened, this in certain cases, it may stop working, it may not start, you know, the air condition altogether, the sag is for a longer period, then it may fail to start. The compressors may come to a stop. Fine. So what is the conclusion made by this air conditioner stall? So they have, this particular case study has been taken for, you know, for 60% depth in your voltage sag, they have maintained, they have a equipment. There's the equipment which can inject a voltage dip of whatever percentage you want. So there is an equipment which will inject a voltage dip into your system. So they have done it with the 60% and 50%, and they have retained this voltage dip for around 40 to 60 cycle, and for 50% around 10 cycle. So what they see when they do this particular case study, they check that the thermal protection causes the compressor to stall. So compressor will come to a stop mode. So it is able to sustain. So you are coming to know that the limit of the compressor of the air conditioner, which can withstand the fault, up to what level of voltage sag, or for how many cycles. You know, the more, and that moment when the current, motor current rise to as high as 4.7 per unit during the sag, because your sag, during the sag, it will, what happen? The current will start increasing, you know, from zero, it will start increasing. So it will not come back to a normal. It will even go higher, increasing, increasing. It is also been observed that it will increase up to 4.7 per unit during the sag. Fine. So that's about your air conditioning system. Similarly, on the lighting loads, you can see that the initiation of the sag happens over here because the current is almost zero. So you can see the X, your Y axis is current. So it's almost equal to zero. So zero current indicating beginning of the sag. And the very interesting part is this case study I like, because this, you know, when we read a book or when we read something like this through PPT or something, certain things are not clear until unless we don't see some practical, you know, waveforms. So this waveforms exactly give me an idea, exactly the point of sag starting and the point of sag ending. So the starting point means their current has fallen to zero. Ending point means where is a sudden inrush peak of your current. Peak current shoots up. So you can see over here what happens. Current spike indicating the end of sag. So here the current sag means the sag is over and the system is trying to come back to its normal state. So this is the kind of waveform has been observed in case of a lighting load. So, and we know the sag is very well observed in case of a lighting loads because we can see the intensity of the light will fall down. So what do you say? The light dims during the sag, which we know that. And it is the dimness of the light or the intensity of the light depends on how depth your sag is. You know, how long the sag duration and how depth of the sag is depends on that. So at the end of the sag, a current occurs resulting in a sharp increase of intensity in light. Exactly. When that means suddenly your current will shoot up and you will come to know, yes, there's a sag is stopping and now the system will come back to, and we have observed it. Okay. I have observed in my house, and I'm very pretty sure that all of you have observed in your house that when the voltage suddenly it comes down and suddenly it increases, it is more visible in terms of a light instead of a fan. You know, fan, we can observe it has been more loaded. You can see the regulator, you kept it in different timing at the same position, but you can feel the speed of the fan at all the time. It's not same because that is the effect of the variation of the load happening on the other end. So, but it is in the light very clearly visible. It will dim. It will again suddenly have shown a very high intensity, and again it will come back to its normal rating. Fine. So, but you know, too much flickering in the lamp will, what will happen? The life of the lamp will go off. The lamp of the light. Whichever light you talk about, LED, LCD, whatever you talk about, incandescent or helium lamps, the life of the lamp will come down. Find that on computers, very important. You know, the very important point is on computers. How does this sag impact on your computer? And as in the present situation where 24/7, we are in front of computers, you know, we all are working on it. And this sags are making so much of impact on your computers. You will be knowing that this experiment has been done over here, you know, 60%, keeping the 60% for 20 cycle and 50% for 30 cycle. And the system that happens, the system automatically go for your restarting mode, or it will be your, when you talk about a loading, that means you're talking about hard disk, you're loading a data on the hard disk. So these are the point which you have to system, they have checked in this particular test that what is the level of the system to keep it where the system will go for a, you know, restarting mode. That has been observed over here, and they have, you can see the system is at zero, sag starts, and you know it is very, very small, which is not observable, but you don't have a zero, but it's almost near to zero, and suddenly when power comes, you know, you get this sudden you get this, and you would have realized it if you are in, especially in online meeting or something, you are listening while talking to somebody in on your meeting or listening, and suddenly you just turn on your charger, even you plug in and put that into your system, you can face that glitches, you know, glitches will come. For a few seconds, you are not able to hear what is happening on the other end. So that is what impact on the computer it makes. You can see the current will go up to 7 to 10 times of the normal current. So it's, which is pretty high. And what happens when you're working and suddenly your computer restarts? There are many things which you are doing very importantly, and the current goes off, you know, and you just lose your data. You just lose your data, and you, so that is what the impact of sag is so serious in terms of, you know, this computers. So what does it say? And mainly it may not impact too much in your, especially when we talk on day-to-day life, we are working on it. Yeah, certain work we are doing and we are not able to save, and the computer suddenly restart due to the problem of sag. But when you talk about servers, you know, they are the mainframe computers, or the servers are, you know, they are really in a serious trouble if such kind of issues happen over there. So the sag typically restart the computer, which results in a loss of data. And this may causes in financial losses when you talk about a trading or in terms of a telecommunications offices. You know, so these are the conclusions made by doing these experiments on the computers. The experiments on microwave, It's agreeable that everybody doesn't have microwave house, but majority, you know, normal middle class to higher classes, everybody has microwave. But what happened in the microwave case? Because this is an another heating load. It's not a lighting load, it's a heating load, you know. So it takes a lot of ampere current. So here what happens when the microwave is on and you experience a sag, a microwave experience a sag in voltage. So inside your microwave light is there, that light will start flickering. You know, that flickering of the light will indicate you, yeah, there is something going wrong at the other end. And that's how they have kept this is for 50% sag depth, and they have did it for 30 cycles. So what they conclude from that, that no microwave oven was damaged due to sags of varying depths and durations, okay? So microwave will not spoil, but that bulb inside that, if it keeps happening, that bulb will definitely spoil, you know? So the microwave oven, so they have done this, I told you 60% depth of for 30 cycles and 50% sag depth for 10 cycle has been conducted. So microwave oven B showed only a visible effects of sags such as flickering. So you can only observe that flickering part. So what is the overall conclusion of all these tests? Fine, so there were a few more I have not taken up. I've just taken this few important loads into our houses. There were a few more done on the house loads and work concluded at the end. So what they find is the most severe affected load in the house is your computer, because that will lose certain data if it's not saved. So otherwise you will not find any major, you know, the major affected loads into your houses. It will not damage much of the system, but definitely, yes, you the certain systems may come to a halt, you know. So the sag may stop the air conditioners in the residential areas. No damage occurred on any one of the loads. The restart can produce overload if all air conditioners are started simultaneously, and further sags can occur. Very important thing, very important. This is what I myself have observed, and you people also would have observed, especially the areas, you know, hot regions like Chennai and Kolkata, like that, which are very, very hot areas. And during that time, if all the ACs are running at the same time and suddenly power goes off, the load completely comes down. And suddenly the power comes up, all the air conditioners start up at the same time. So when such a huge load start up at the same time, definitely there is a voltage dip, a huge voltage dip will be there. So in residential area, SAG has minimum financial consequences to the owners. So we don't go across, the financial losses comes for a big industries, you know, the big industries or trademarks where trade sectors, those who experience this kind of losses. So here we don't have much of damage. The only serious issue is we may lose certain data if we are working on system. Otherwise, not much affected. Yeah, so the interesting part, I hope even you guys will also enjoy, that is a quiz time. And by the knowledge of module one and the module two, the first lecture, I'm pretty sure that all of you will be able to answer all the questions, because they are quite simple. So let us start. Question number one, a dash is a decrease to between 0.1 and 0.9 per unit in RMS voltage or current at a power frequency for durations from 0.5 cycle to 1 minute. Fast, may I get the answer fast? Yes. I know all of you know that the question is related to the today's lecture only. So I know all of you will be able to answer this. Fine. What is that? It's called as a sag. You know, anything between 0.5 cycle to 1 minute is defined under voltage sag. And anything below between your 0.1 to 0.9 per unit of RMS voltage defined as voltage sags, which is there for 0.5 cycle, for a duration of 0.5 cycle to 1 minute. Anything more than 1 minute, what do we call it? Anything, any sag more than 1 minute. Yes, good. We call it as under voltage. Okay. Next. Dash results in complete loss of voltage. What results in complete loss of voltage? Yes, I hope majority of you are able to answer if you are watching the video properly from the beginning till end. It's called as interruption. Fine. Third question. Reducing the number of short circuit faults in the system reduces. What will reduce? You know, what is the major cause? You know, the major, just not so long, the whole lecture we are talking about, the short circuit faults are the major cause. For what? That is only the answer for this question. So if you are able to reduce the short circuit faults in your system, you will be able to reduce the number of sags and the interruptions. As simple as that, you will be able to reduce the number of sags and interruption. I hope these three quizzes were very easy and you were able to, all of you are able to answer, right? So these quizzes will help you to understand, is that really you have understood the whole lecture or not? You know, if it is there, if you think you are able to answer all the questions, then very good. I think you have understood the whole lecture. The most common cause of long interruption is, yes, the most common cause of long interruption, when the long interruption will come. Okay, I hope all of you know it's due to the faults or outages. Long interruptions means this is mainly due to the faults and outages. Any sudden large increase in load will cause a dash in motors. What will happen? If the sudden load will increase, what will happen into the motors? Motors will also experience a voltage sag. Okay. Motors will also experience a voltage sag. Transmission breakers will typically clear a fault in. Yes, we have discussed in today's lecture. It will clear a typical fault in. Fast. Yes, I hope you are telling the correct answer. It is 5 or 6 cycles. Okay. So the transmission breakers will typically clear the fault in 5 or 6 cycles. Good, those who are able to answer this question. Next question. During sag, power electronic component will trip. This will decrease what? During sag, power electronic components will trip. You know, so this will decrease what? It will decrease load current. Fine, it will decrease load current. Yes, the last and the final question, which will summarize the whole chapter. The major cause of voltage sag is switching off large loads. Correct. Number two, you know, you will talk about faults. Short circuit faults can be single line to ground fault, can be line to line fault. Number three, what? Equipment failure. Any equipment can fail at the utility end. Number four, starting of large induction machines. You know, all the ledger, or very, whether you say the starting of large induction machines or you talk about the starting of huge loads, you know, it need not to be always machines. It can be any top. Just now we were talking about the starting of huge, you know, ACs, all the air conditioners. Okay, though they are inductive in nature, but still they will also cause an dip. Malfunction of primary components, which are very essential neat components to run your system healthier. Then if those systems fail, definitely your voltage will dip. Fine. Thank you for listening to today's lecture. I hope all of you have enjoyed my lecture and take a good care of yourself. We'll meet in the next lecture. Thank you, guys.